So the joy of the Lord is your strength. That's what Nehemiah said. And Nehemiah, when they was reading the law, they were reading the commandments and stuff, it said that the people understood the words that were spoken to them. That's where the joy of the Lord comes from. You know, you can come to church, sit here, and not pay attention, and walk out and going, I didn't get much out of it. Or you can sit here and pay attention and open your heart, and the words, Jesus said, the words that I speak are spirit and life. The Bible is not just a book. It's God's Word. So when it speaks, it has God's life on it. That word life is Zoe, Z-O-E-Y, eternal life. It speaks to a deep places inside if you have ears to hear. For the joy of the Lord is your strength, is what Nehemiah said, because they had understood the words that were declared unto them. When you understand, I wrote, joy comes when you understand God's purpose and plan. I mean, when God reveals to you His purpose and plan, or shows you He's going to... Anybody got problems? Most of us. You that didn't raise your hand? Fibber. We all got problems. We got problems on all kinds of different levels and stuff. But when the Lord shows you His plan, how He's going to get you through that problem, there's where the joy comes in. Oh, yeah, well, okay. I mean, if God shows you His plan, He's good to make it happen, right? Has God ever failed anybody?
Never.
No, not once. Some of you are going, I don't know. I've had some failures in my life. Well, that's you. I said, has God ever failed you? Sometimes people, I did what God said and didn't work out. You go back and check your notes better on that one. Did you do all what God said? I hit most of it. I mean, obedience is pretty important with God, that you obey it to the letter. You just don't kind of, well, I was in the ballpark. When you understand His plans and purpose, that's where the joy comes in. Because you understand. Well, there's a story in the Bible, there's many of them, but there's one with this rich young ruler comes to Jesus and says, hey, what must I do to have eternal life? Isn't that a pretty important question?
Oh, yeah.
Does anybody want to live forever?
Yeah.
Me and Dave. Gosh, people. Anybody want to live forever?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, me. Yeah, eternal life. You want to live forever. He's clarifying. I thought you meant this life. How about the life? How many of y'all, when you die, you want to go, put it this way, in terms you might understand. How many, when you die, you want to go to heaven? Okay. How many want to go to hell? No, no takers. Okay, good. Got the right crowd with us, I'm making sure. When you die, you want to go to heaven. Just FYI, heaven's a blast. You get to fly. Does anybody want to fly? Man, I saw this guy. I've been on my porch the last few weeks with my friend Dave, and he's sitting where you can see... He goes, there's that parachute guy. There's some parasailer over on Pine Street flying around with a parachute. Looks like fun, but there's some factors there that just kind of, what if it collapses? Yeah, just there's things that I look at that going, it looks like fun, but it's not safe fun. I want to fly when I can just fly, like Superman. Do you know the Bible says you get to fly?
That's in the Bible.
Yeah, it says when he left, he ascended into heaven. Isn't that flying?
Yeah.
The Bible says when you get your resurrected body, you're going to be like Christ. You get to do things He did. So when you're at the beach and you're throwing the frisbee and you're running out there, you could be possibly walking on water when you catch it.
Yeah.
He can walk on water. He can walk through walls.
Well, you know, that's impossible because solid matter can't go through.
Well, Jesus did. Some of you are going, I just thought we're going to walk around in white robes with little harps going, bring, hallelujah, bring, hallelujah, bring, hallelujah. No, we're going to eat food that, oh my goodness, we're going to have angel food cake made from with angels. You talk about it floating. It's like, hey, I like a piece of that cake. Whoa. The best is yet to come. How many of you saves the best for the last, for his kids? Oh man, I can't wait to go there. Hallelujah. Glorified bodies. Bodies that don't experience pain. I'm on board with that one. So there's so many wonderful things coming up. The Bible says in heaven you'll be known as you're known. Everybody's going to know you. You won't have name tags. People walk up and know you. Won't that be awesome? Everybody's friendly. Nobody's having a bad day. No cramps. In heaven. No might all. No any of that stuff. Hallelujah. Just clarify, I felt in the spirit. You know? It's gonna be no PMS, yeah. Hallelujah. Everybody's gonna love one another. Isn't that a place you want to go to? Man. See, the Bible always gives you, when it tells you something, it always tells you the end result of, if you keep my commandments, then this is going to happen. If you don't, this is going to happen. So the joy comes when you find out what God's purpose and plan is and you start doing it. You could know at the end, well, that's what he said he's going to do. If I do this, he said he'll do that. So, you know, some people highlight in their Bibles, you know, the promises of God and things. Really, you only need to highlight the part you're responsible for. You don't have to highlight his part. He's good for his part. A lot of times we're highlighting, oh, he said he's going to do this. Well, I notice you didn't highlight what you have to do. That's really important that you highlight that part, because you got to do that part to get this part. So y'all just kind of like, oh. Oh, maybe that's why these plans, maybe that's why the joy of the Lord's not kicking. All right, this rich young ruler comes to Jesus and says, what must I do to inherit eternal life? That's a big question, and it's an important question. Everybody lives forever, it's just not everybody goes to the place where, you know, people in hell live forever. That's not living. Yeah. So, very important question. Jesus said, well, keep the commandments. He said, well, I've done that. He said, I've done those from my youth. He said, Jesus didn't say, you liar. He said, you're right. You only lack one thing. You only got one thing left you need to take care of. I've been serving Jesus almost 45 years. Now, he's yet to tell me, Mike, you get down to one thing. So this rich young ruler was doing something right. He said, you lack one thing. He said, go and sell your possessions, give the money to the poor, come follow me, you'll have riches in heaven. Now here's where it gets tricky. It says that he walked away sorrowful, for he had great riches. How many people did Jesus ever came to Jesus specifically wanting something from the Lord that walked away sorrowful? Very, very few. Blind people came to him, walked away seeing. Crippled came to him, walked away walking. You know, I mean, most people that sought him out had an encounter with him and walked away with something. Even those that were hungry, he fed 5,000 with a couple fish and a few loaves of bread. This guy is seeking the Lord out. And I'm not talking about the scribes and Pharisees, because there's lots of scripture about how they just didn't get it. Amen? If you're a Pharisee, you're in the wrong place. You will not be comfortable today. I will let you know that. Amen? Pharisees are religious people trying to live by the law and trying to be good enough, and you can't do that. So he says, you lack one thing. He says, go sell everything you got, give it to the poor. Come on, follow me. And he walked away sorrowful. What he didn't understand was, if he had did what Jesus said and followed the Lord, what would have been the outcome for his life? More than doubled. But you're on it, Sean. Hundredfold. He could have got 100 times what he gave away. You say, is that in the Bible? Well, glad you asked. Yes, it is. In Mark chapter 10, verse 28, Peter says, Lord, we've left all to follow you. We give up everything, man. We've sold out. For any of you that think that when you go to your prayer closet, if you can brag on how much you've suffered for him, you're not going to get a lot of points with Jesus on this one. So you might as well not even go there. Remember, Elijah goes, "I'm the only one," especially when you start telling God, "You're number one." Doesn't really ring the bell, you know? Elijah tried that. "I'm the only prophet left. Everybody else is, you know, not faithful." And God says, "Shut up. I got 7,000, never bowed a knee to Baal. You're not the only one." Don't ever think that somebody's salvation is totally resting on you. Amen? Sometimes we think that, "Oh, I failed the Lord. I was supposed to witness God and I didn't do it. Oh, if he's lost." God isn't putting this man's eternal salvation on you. Amen? He's got lots of people that he can run into along the way. You ain't the only one. Neither am I. Well, Peter tried that with the Lord and it didn't go very far. He said, "We've left all, Lord. I gave up my nets, my fishing and father and son, fishing business, all this kind of stuff, trying to impress the Lord." And the Lord said, "Peter, you shut up. You didn't give up anything that you won't get back in this life." He says, 100. You don't give up husbands, wives, children, brothers. And he goes down the list. Lands, homes. That you won't get back in this life 100-fold. 100 times. He says, with persecutions. That's his little kicker. That's with persecutions. You're going to get persecuted with it, but it's in there. Amen? And he says, and eternal and the life to come, eternal life. You get eternal life, but if this rich young ruler had stuck around and followed Jesus, he would have ended up twice as rich, 100 times more wealthy. I mean, Job lost everything. The difference between Job and Peter, Job lost everything and said this, "The Lord giveth, the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." He didn't sit there and say, "Well, I've done this and I've done that." He didn't try to justify himself. He just humbled himself and rolled with it. Sometimes you just need to roll with it. Complaining will get you nada. And that, there's a method to my madness this morning. I'm going somewhere with this. I want you to understand, you need to be careful what you hang out with, what's in your home, because certain things will tap out the joy of the Lord. We're going to get, that's the kicker at the end. Let's just keep going. He said, "You lack one thing." He walked away sorrowful because he didn't understand the purpose and plan of God. In John chapter, St. John chapter 15, I'm glad my friends from Julian are here today. Hallelujah. All right, let's look at this. John 15, verse 9. It says, "As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you." How does Jesus love you? Just like God does. "Continue in my love. If you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love, even as," or just like, "I have kept my Father's commandments and abided in his love. These things have I spoke to you, that my joy," whose joy? His. And this is about the joy of the Lord. "That my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full." There's a difference between your joy and his joy. How many of y'all want his? It's a better quality of joy. So, he says he wants that my joy might remain in you. You know, the problem with the joy of the Lord is it has a tendency to slip away. It does. Have you ever noticed the things of God are contingent sometimes on, well, not sometimes, on our obedience? Can the Lord bless you if you're doing something stupid? He can. You're calling on his mercy. But sometimes, how about the law of sowing and reaping? Is that a universal law? Yeah, it is. Here's one right here. It's called gravity. There you go. And what goes up comes down. It's a universal law. Now, God could cause that to sustain itself, but, you know, the guy with the parasail? The only problem with that is there's a law that if that motor gives out and the wind shifts or something, or a string breaks, gravity's going to lay hold of that apparatus. And he could do what that water bottle just did and fall. And this guy's pretty high up there. Well, you know, if you know how to roll, I love those eternal optimist guys. They're always, well, you know, if you tuck and roll. Yeah, tuck and roll. Okay. He says, keep my commandments. I wrote equals abide in his love. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. How do you know you love God? Because I got this warm, fuzzy feeling when I say Jesus. Oh, it comes all over me. I get chicken skin. My hair stands up on my arms. Oh, that's emotion. That's emotion. Don't trust in your emotions, because your emotions can be feeling really good today, and tomorrow you could be flatlined emotionally. Emotions come and go. You can be feeling the difference between the joy of the Lord and happiness is you can be all happy, and somebody walking going, "You look stupid. Shut up." What happened? You were all happy? See, happiness is a product of your environment. The world gets happy. Don't worry. That's right. The world can get happy. It can't get joy. Because the joy, Bible says joy is a fruit of the Spirit. It's what? A fruit of the Spirit. It comes from being a child of God. You get joy. Is joy better than happiness? Oh, yeah. Happiness is a product of your environment. How many of your environment can change real quickly? A guy came to our church years ago in a brand new Corvette. He was all happy showing that thing off. All right. After church, somebody backed into it. Well, didn't leave the church as happy as he came. Because fiberglass meets metal. Metal won. See, he was all happy because he had this brand new Corvette. Then somebody didn't see it and crunched it. You say, was he? Well, he didn't. I know the guy. He didn't freak out and throw a fit, whatever. But he was not happy. As a Christian, did he still have joy? Yes. Joy is the sustaining power that enables you to get through things when you're going through trials and stuff that most people quit. Joy will give you the strength to keep on keeping on. It gives you strength. You ever feel like quitting? Man, yeah. I mean, we're living in a time where, I don't know if you watch the news, I think it's designed to make you want to quit. If you feel sparky when you start the news, after a half hour of that good report, you just about want to quit. I'll never forget one time I was at this, when I first moved here, I knew I was in trouble. I went to the swap meet down at the, where the sports arena is. And I walked up, and this guy had a bunch of rocks. They were just rocks. And I said, what's with this? Well, these are soothing stones. He said, they have a lot of metaphysical properties in them. I pick them up. Look like a river rock to me. I'm a country boy. I've fished and hiked and camped all over the place and been to Tennessee. Lots of river rock up there. And I picked it up, and he said, yes, yes. Feel it smooth? Yeah. I said, so what would you do with this? It was $50. He said, well, this is something you'd probably want to hold when you're watching the news because it would soothe you. And I'm thinking, I don't know what news you're watching, but I don't want a rock in my hand when I'm watching the evening news. Because I don't know about you, I want to throw it. I don't know what political persuasion you are, but I want to chunk something. You know, so I just figured, nah, I knew God had called me to a, Lord, what land did you send me to? God's got a sense of humor, don't he? He sends a guy from Mississippi and puts him right down in San Diego. Oh, you're going to have a fun time over there, Michael. I can see him and Jesus high-fiving in heaven. He ain't got a clue where he's going. I get out here and it's like, my goodness, people are just different. I had neighbors years ago I used to wave to all the time. They looked at me like I was asking, you know, for their firstborn child or something. And they're like rolling up their window and stuff. This went on for weeks. I couldn't take it. I stood out on the road one day waiting for this guy to come home. I saw him coming. I just went out there and stopped. And he stopped. And I went over and he rolled down his window and I said, howdy, I'm Mike Hall. I live right here in this house. You go by every day. There's only 6 other houses on the back of this road. We're neighbors. I'm going to keep waving to you, so I figure you better start waving back. Because I'm not changing. So we need to work this out. He said, I didn't know who you were. I thought you, because he said, I see you on that tractor sometime. I thought you was a hired hand. Oh, what? Can't wave to the hired help? No, I actually live here. I'm in the neighborhood. And he said, okay. So, you know, from that day on, guess what? Every time he went down there, he's looking for me. Wave to the crazy man. Okay. So he won't come to our house. Okay. But, I'm a Southern man. I believe in Southern hospitality. I believe in present yourself friendly. I believe that every human being's important. I'm one of these guys that believes all lives matter. Yes. Amen? I believe you should be nice to everybody. When I go to the post office, I'm opening the door for people and stuff. Why? Because I just want to be friendly. Yes. Discipleship doesn't start just amongst us. It better be working outside the house. Yes. So, we got to keep His commandments. That's how you know you love God. You keep His commandments.
Amen.
Yeah, that went over real well. You keep His commandments. I keep the ones I like. I didn't say that. Blessed is the man that keeps the commandments he likes. No, he keeps the commandments. And it says if you keep the commandments, it says you'll abide, dwell, stay in the same place. You'll stay in the love of God. How many of y'all want to stay in the love of God? Man, the love of God is, there's where the peace is. All right, let's keep looking at this. If you keep my commandments, you'll abide in my love, even as, or just like I've kept my Father's commandments and abide in His love. These things have I spoken to you that you might, I've spoken to you, that my joy might remain in you and that your joy might be full. Hey, when Jesus prayed, did God ever answer His prayers? Last I checked, all of them. Why did God always answer Jesus' prayers? Because Jesus walked in total obedience. You ever find that when you're walking in obedience, things tend to go a little better for you? Isn't that kind of quinkadink right there? Things go better when you're in obedience? That's how Jesus said, so if you're walking in this obedience, you're walking in love, He said, my joy is going to remain in you. And that's going to cause your joy to be full. Because when you pray and God answers your prayers, anybody ever get happy when God answers your prayers? Oh my goodness, yes. He recently did something for me that I thought might take a while to really make happen, but He made it happen in a week. Hallelujah. I mean, just boom. I'm watching this thing going, I don't know, it's going to take a heck of a while, but all of a sudden, boom. Free at last. I'm being careful. We're watching on YouTube. So, Brenda and I are celebrating 25 years of marriage this November. Been married 20. That's a good thing. And in the 25 years we've been married, we've had 2 weeks that was just her and I. Without kids, neighbors, people. Just 2 weeks. Best 2 weeks of my life. In the Caribbean, boy. When Jesus comes back, if I get to rule and reign with Him, I'm hoping it's an island ministry. Hallelujah. And if you an island kind of person, I hope we get to hang on the same island. Hallelujah. But 2 weeks. My son moved out a few weeks ago and almost had an empty nest. Grandma's living with us. But through some turn of events, she decides she wants to go live at Vicky's house. And I said, okay. so So she's at Vicky's house, and I got an empty nest. I mean, I'm telling you, I'm happy about this because I want this is the part I want you to understand about the joy of the Lord. How many know that people around you affects you? I'm going to tell you something. You've got to have sanctuary in your house. When you go home, you might not can. You can't affect the people you work with. You don't get to pick and choose who those people are, you know. But when you go home, you get behind closed doors, you got to be able to say, as for me and my house, we serve God. No demonic spirits allowed in this place. The angels of God encamp round about them that fear him. I believe angels stand over your house because some angels are huge. I've seen angels. I saw one time, just the Lord let me see his foot. It was about 20 foot long. Some of these angels can be huge. I asked the Lord in prayer. I said, Lord, I like your presence, and I like angels to stand over this place tonight and keep everything away that would hinder the move of God. And I'm leading worship one night and look over there, and I see that God just makes the wall disappear, and I see this big foot with a sandal on it. And that's all I saw. You saw Bigfoot? Yeah, I saw. Yeah, I knew it was an angel. And Lord, let me see that my prayers were being answered. And we need to know there's angelic assistance around us. In Psalms 103, it says he gives his angels charge over us. Amen? That they'll watch. The angels of the Lord encamp round about those that fear him. I want angels. You ever feel peace when you come out to my house? There's peace at my house. Y'all come up, you'll feel more peace today.
Amen.
I want to tell you, you can't allow strife in your home. I actually talk to people sometimes. I won't live in strife. If me and Brenda are kind of butting heads on some things, I just got to get her in a headlock, get a little noogie, and pray over, lay hands on her, you know. Yeah, get it. Yeah. 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 Several walls between me and her right now. No, no. We not this one. No. How many know when you have strife between your mate that there's the house is just not peaceful. You got to have peace in your own home. I'll tell you something. Negative emotions drain power. You ever notice when you get mad, you just start getting tired? Oh, at first you feel energized. Well, gee, you what? Man, you always tell when Brenda's mad at me, come out to my house, man. She's cleaning. It's like, honey, you know, that thing will work better if you plug it in. Man, she's vacuuming. And she's, you know, the Bible says be angry but sin not. Do you ever notice you get, when you're angry, you're motivated, you have it. You know, you want use that for some good. Go out and chop wood. Do something. Use that anger to benefit somebody. But better yet, deal with it. Amen?
Right.
But you'll find that anger will drain you. It's almost like drinking a Coke. Woohoo! You feel all, you know. It's the real thing. About an hour later, gosh. All that sugar hits you and you feel great. But man, it gets you up, but you come down pretty hard. Negative emotions drain you. When someone's mad at you or somebody's indifferent. That's what my wife used to say when we first got married. I didn't know what that word meant. She had a lot bigger vocabulary than me. And I'd say, honey, are you mad at me? No, I'm just indifferent. And I thought she was saying, I'm different. I missed that indifferent. I finally had to look it up. What does this indifferent mean? Oh, you just don't care. Oh, well, that's not good. You're not mad? No, I'm just indifferent. And I thought, well, cool, if you're not mad, then I'm okay. But I started realizing, no, you're not mad. You just don't care. But I want you to care because we're married. I find that you get along better when you care. Hallelujah. But, you know, we started working on some things because I don't want her to be indifferent. You know, sometimes we take the high ground like, you're just gonna be a moron. So I'm just gonna pretend I don't care. You can't just take that kind of. I'm speaking to people today. Some of y'all are even like, where's this coming from? Some of y'all are going, I've been trying to dodge this bullet all morning, but it seems like he's tracking with a laser sight. Because God wants us to deal with this stuff. Because negative emotions drain power. And I'm saying all that to say this. You know, how many of the Bible says that you got to love Jesus more than anybody, anything? You know, you got to love Jesus more than your husband and your wife. You got to love Jesus more than your kids. You got to love Jesus more than your mom and dad. I do. I do. And I'm going to tell you something. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. And if you're going to live in my house, we're going to obey the book. We don't just go out and read it as something that we do as Christians. Hi, I'm reading the Word of God. You got to do it. I know people, I see them sitting out there reading the Bible. Well, that's good, but reading it, you know, they didn't even have Bibles in Jesus' day. There's a church in Collinsville, Mississippi, out front, it says, we use the King James Version like Paul did. Yeah, you know old Paul walking around with that King James Bible. I'm going to Philippi. Going to the Corinth church to preach to the Corinthians. They didn't have Bibles, people. Jesus said, the Holy Spirit will remind you of the things I said. Why would we have to remind us? Can't we just read it? It wasn't around. So what did they do? They used the name of Jesus and accomplished more just using His name than we did with all our commentaries. It's not about reading the book. It's about doing what is written in the book. So when people call themselves Christians and they read the book and they do this stuff, at some point, if what you're reading is not lining up with your life, if your walk and your talk don't go together, at some point, Jesus is going to talk to you. Oh, He's going to talk to you quietly, spirit to spirit. And then if you're not listening, He's going to send the Holy Ghost and He's going to talk to you, spirit to spirit. But if you don't listen to Him, third's a charm. The Bible says the Word will be made flesh. God will send somebody in flesh form, a person, and they will come and talk to you about what your disobedience. Amen? Third's a charm. So if somebody's coming to you and talking to you about your disobedience, you're on strike three. Don't take the high ground like, well, I'll tell you what. You're at strike three. Amen? Jesus has already talked to you. The Holy Spirit's already talked to you. Now somebody's telling you, you need to deal with this. Well, I've just recently got to do this. Don't y'all love when somebody brings correction? We should, but we don't. We like to find fault with the person or whatever and stuff so we don't have to listen to their message. That's the nature of human beings. We find fault with the message so we can negate the message or the messenger in the message. Therefore, we can just walk away feeling justified. Well, this happened recently. But I'm just telling you, I shared the truth and said some things got to change. Now, it would be great if people would say, well, you know, I appreciate that. I appreciate you sharing truth with me because I want to live right. I want to live a life that's pleasing to my Heavenly Father. I don't want to live in strife. In the perfect world, that's the proper response. But most people don't always respond that way. Some people respond, you know, their nostrils flare and their eyeballs bug out a little bit and they don't hear you. How many times does Jesus talk to us about things and we just... It's sad when the years should speak. If the Lord's still speaking to you after 30 years, you need to pay attention.
Amen. Yeah.
40, 50, 60, 70, 80 years and you're still not there. That's not good. It's not good. Hallelujah. Well, I want to tell you something. Because I had this talk because I'm going to live in peace. I know in my occupation, I should stay edified.
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, that'd be kind of important. I mean, if you're in your line of work, if you're a crane operator, how many of you should be sober? I'm just throwing it out there. It would probably be good if you, you know, operating crane, moving stuff around, you should probably be focused and sober. It's probably in your job description. I'm just guessing. Yeah. So there's certain things on all of our jobs that have requirements that they would like us to be on time, wear a helmet if we're working around dangerous stuff. There's certain requirements, and I think being sober is one of them. And a lot of times when you join a company and stuff, they have rules of conduct, how you should treat one another, how you should say no profanity and all this kind of stuff, no sexual harassment and stuff, you know. Hello. That makes for a good working environment. Amen? Yeah, well, I got a book that tells me how I'm supposed to act too. And I need to be edified. That means built up. Because I never know when you're going to walk through the door or I'm going to pick up the phone, somebody's going to say, hey, I got a crisis on my hand. I got a situation. I got to have my soul at a good place. I need to be chipper. I don't need to be fighting with Bren. Shut up. You shut up. Hello? Yes. Praise God. What's going on? Yeah. Oh, yeah. We'll be praying about that. Glory to God. You got it. Uh-huh. Shut up! Now, y'all might not see that, and that's really not what goes on. But if it did, the thing is, we can't fake God out. How many of y'all don't want to fake anybody out anyways? Isn't it better to live honest? The thing about living honest is, you don't, because when you lie, you forget who all you lied to. Just tell the truth. It's easier. It's easier to remember the truth. Hallelujah. So, when I've been dealing with some things in my family where home was getting to be a place of contention and friction. So I recently just had this talk and said, hey, some things got to change because I don't like coming home. Now you're talking about Brenda. If you're going, oh, poor Brenda. It's not me and Brenda. So figure out who's left, and that's what we're talking about. So I had this talk, and I said, you know, things have got to change. And the thing is, some people would rather move or do something else than actually change. I'll tell you, that's a sad thing. The Bible says, when the years should speak. If you're 40, you're 40 years old, man, you're old enough to think your years should speak. You've been on the planet 40 years. You should have something to say. You should have figured it out by now. If you're 60 or 70, they should speak. Well, I came to this place recently where I said, you know, I'm not going to keep living like this. Something's got to change. So a lot of times you have to confront stuff. You can't, you know, I'm a patient person, but anybody a stuffer? Just me? You know, I deal with people's problems all the time. Sometimes I go home, I just want to go, I'm off work. I don't want to deal with stuff anymore. And I just kind of, but at some point you have to say, as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. You have to make war to have peace. You can only sit outside so long. You know, I've got a nice porch and I got a nice breeze up there, so I don't mind my porch. But at some point you got to say, you know what? And I'm a pretty gracious man. I can get along with about anybody. But what I found out recently, and I'm sharing this with you because I think it's detrimental if you don't hear what I'm saying. You may have the grace to endure. Hear the word, endure some people's attitudes. But I don't think it's the will of God that we walk around enduring all the time. Amen? I think at some point you don't want to have, because that enduring is draining you. At some point, you got to be able to, not be drained, but at some point you got to be able to put it back in. You got to be able to start putting power back. When I go home, and when I come to the office, man, I want to put in the battery. I want to charge the battery. I don't want to drain the battery. And even if I can get along with people and endure their attitudes and problems, at some point you've got to say, you know what, I'm not going to do this. Now, I understand if it's for somebody's salvation, that's different. The Bible says, endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. But when you're dealing with saints, when you're dealing with sons and daughters of God who should not be like this at this point in their life, You're not doing any favors to endure, well, you know, that's just that's how so-and-so is, always been that way. You're not doing them a favor by letting them stay that way. Because if enough of us say, you got to change, you're an old cantankerous booger. I ain't going to keep living like this. So, well, you can't say that. I did. What happens? I want to tell you something. Sometimes people will try to trump you with, husbands will go, I'm your husband, submit to me. Listen, don't use that trump card as though you don't, if they're speaking truth to you, you've got to hear what they're saying. I'm your mother, I'm your father, obey me, honor me. I honor you, but I don't honor your behavior. At some point, Dad, you got to quit acting this way. At some point, Mom, you can't keep doing this. I'm your mother. Yes, you are. But, you know, we're equals. I'm grown up. I'm not this little kid anymore. You've got to quit being rude, unkind. You got to quit hurting people's feelings. See, being a mom don't give you the right to be a brat. So you go, I've got a Mother's Day card that says that. Hallmark's got everybody covered. But here's what I want you to see. In your home, in these last days, you need to make sure that your house is set in order. Because you need to come home to an edifying place. You need to be able to come in and be at peace. It's important to live in peace. The Bible says the fruit of righteousness is peace. When things are right, you'll have peace in your home. I didn't have peace in my home till recently. Boy, howdy, I slept good last night. I had trouble getting up this morning. I was in REM sleep, which I found out I've been missing. Because people can carry in their person funk, attitude, resentment. Amen? And it permeates through the house. So let's deal with this stuff. Let's just say in the name of Jesus, I'm going to grow up. I don't want what Brother Mike's talking about to be what people are thinking and talking about me down the road. I want to be the person that's going, I didn't think that'd be you. You're so sweet. You're so kind. He said, if you want my joy to remain in you, you've got to walk in love. And you do that by keeping His commandments. You know, the commandments of God says that you have to treat people kind. The Bible talks about the law of kindness. I mean, you have to be nice to people. Religious people walk around and hurt people's feelings trying to be justified, saying, well, I'm just speaking the truth in love. No, you're just mean. The only time we find Jesus kind of throwing it out there was religious people that were trying to hide behind their disobedience. That's the only people He was really ripping. Hello? He wasn't ripping sinners. The woman caught in the act of adultery, and they threw her at His feet. He wasn't out there going, what are you doing, man? Stone her. Come on, knock her out. Give me a rock. I'll show you. He didn't do that. He knew she was set up. He was going after the people that had the rocks in their hand. He was going after the culprit. I love that about Jesus. I'm not talking about you that are young in the Lord, that are learning the ways of God and still dealing with your soul. There's grace for all that. I'm talking about, the Bible says, for a time when you ought to. When you ought to. You've heard enough teaching. You know enough about what the Word says. This anger in you should not be there. This resentment should not be there. This gossip should not be there. This liking to talk about bad things. There's something wrong with that. The Bible says whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of a good report, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest. Speak on these things. There's something wrong when you when you can't wait to tell somebody something bad about somebody else. You know, there was an accident on the highway last week. That was a terrible thing. We don't go around telling everybody, did you hear about the wreck? There's something wrong about you wanting to... That's somebody's son. That's somebody's child. We don't talk about it like it's a good thing. It's a tragic thing. Well, there's just not that much good stuff to talk about. Well, then you better get on a mission of going out doing some good things so you can talk about what you're doing. It's not CBS and NBC and ABC's job to always find the good reports out there. You know, bad news is easy to find. You know, dirt's not very valuable because it's everywhere. But, you know, in the midst of all the dirt on the earth, there's gold in them, their hills. What makes gold valuable is rare. There's good in every one of us. Everybody in this room has something really good and cool about you that makes you different from everybody else on the planet. We need to find out the gold about in your life instead of the dirt. The dirt's easy to see. What's the gold in your life? What's that thing that God has worked in you that is so cool that I can't wait to find that out about you? Everybody's got gold. It takes a wise man to find the gold. A fool can find dirt all day long. So, wow, Brother Michael, this started off kind of funny. I was kind of enjoying it, but it's kind of getting serious. It's kind of sounding like it applies possibly to me. Scores! It applies to all of us. This message isn't aimed at anybody. This is for all of us. I'm telling you that don't love anybody more than Jesus. And if you're living with strife and things in your home, don't walk around coward and afraid to confront it. At some point, say, you know, I love you, but, you know, if you're married to an unbeliever, go to that person and say, I love you, but you got to quit talking about Jesus. You know, you cuss like a sailor, but, you know, when you say GD, that bothers me. Don't use the Lord's name in vain. You know, I tolerate all the other stuff you do, but don't do that. And they make look to you and go, well, tell you what, rah, rah, rah. Make a deal. So every time you use his name in vain, I'm going to praise him. I'll tell you what, you'll win. He'll be out there, boom, GD. He'll be, thank you, Jesus. Every time he says the Lord's name in vain, praise God. Turn off the vacuum cleaner. Glory to God. Eventually, he's going to quit. Because he's going to realize that bothers you. And I believe that he does love you. Sometimes these things are habits. But see, little things like that, Jesus said, little foxes get the vine. It's those little things. You ever watch a movie and the language gets to the point that it's not enjoyable anymore? Now, if you're at the movie theater, sometimes you feel like, yeah, I got an investment. I got $12 in tickets and I got another $15 in concessions here. I got almost $30 invested in this thing. But something inside you saying, you should leave. This is because the time you leave the movie, the action and special effects aren't worth the way you feel when you get to the car. Because when you get in the car, there's Jesus. Because he's done left the movie. You know, he's done gone. He ain't going to sit there with you. Oh, isn't this edifying? He'll just say, I'll be in the car. The Holy Spirit just goes and sits in the car and waits for you, and you get in the car. How was the movie? Well, the bad guys got it. Sounds like you got it. Where's your joy? It left about 10 minutes into the movie. See, you can't be in disobedience and expect blessing. You can't listen to garbage and then expect wonderful things to come out your mouth. At some point, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it flow the issues of life. The point I'm trying to make this morning, you can't control the theaters, you can't control Hollywood, you can't control your work environment, but you can't control your home. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Beth, I'm overdue. I'm in some peace right now that was overdue. I just brought one correction and poof. You realize some of your friends and family members, they're one correction away from getting their little red wagon and shaking their little booty. There they go. Off they go. Just all mad at you. We don't need to live like that. Because all the good that you've done is for naught after that one correction. Just tell them one time, that's not right. Christians, you know the Bible's full of corrections? Lots of them. We have this stupid idea of thinking, I got corrected till I was 18, but when I turned 18, I'm a grown-up. Really? I ain't met one 18-year-old that's a grown-up. I'm 61. I'm not quite a grown-up yet. I'm almost there. We need to grow up. Part of growing up is admitting that you got some errors you need to deal with. You know, the Bible says, I love the scripture, it says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all this within me, bless his holy name. Then it says, let me look it up. Psalms 34. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be made glad. Oh, magnify the Lord, not the problem. And let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord and he heard me and delivered me from all of my fears. The root of 90% of all of our problems is fear. We're afraid to let go of that thing, but that thing that we're hanging on to is killing us anyways. Perfect love casts out fear. Sometimes it's control. Some people are trying to hold on to that thing. Well, I'm your mother. I'm your father. Yes, but that doesn't mean you control me. I mean, when you accepted Jesus, you came out. Even God won't control you. We come under his rulership, his lordship, but not his control. Rob, you still got free will. You came here today out of choice. Marcia, you came here today out of choice, not a sacrifice. It would have been easier just to stay home and rest, but you wanted to get to the house of God. God's honoring that. I'll tell you, it's choice. We all get choice in this. God doesn't want a bunch of robots. He doesn't want to program us to control us. He wants us to do it spontaneously as an act of our will. Amen? You know, when you get a gift for your birthday, you almost expect it, right? But when somebody gets you something really nice and it's not your birthday, how many of those days, those gifts seem to ring hard, a little more true than the other ones. What'd you get this for? Well, this is really nice. You get your wife a really pretty ring, she goes, whoa, baby, this is really nice. Yeah, why'd you get it? Because I love you. What's the occasion? I love you. No, really, why'd you do it? Because I love you. Would you do? Would you do? I'm gonna get online and look at the bank statement. I'm gonna see what you did. Did you buy a boat or something? What's going on? No, baby. I just did it because I love you. Amen. Those are the gifts that resonate loud. Then honeymoons, Valentine's, Christmas, and stuff. Those are expected. I love it when God just blows your socks off out of the blue. How many of those blessings freak you out? You ever notice sometimes after you've done something really stupid and then you repented and you really repented and then the Lord turned around, seems like the next day or later that afternoon, and just came in with a big old blessing and you're like, I mean, you just feel way undone. It's like, oh, Lord, this is just too, you can't do this. This is too good. I messed up. He goes, yeah, but I forgave you. Yeah, but I haven't paid for it. He goes, you don't have to. My son did. I can't believe you're doing it. I love you. I felt this would be an opportune time to show you that I love you. It's not based on your behavior. It's based on I love you. Amen? Now, I'm not saying that excusing bad behavior, because that goes against keeping his commandments. But, you know, on our best days, we don't do that great. Really, we don't. So it's really about his grace and how good God is, not about how great we are. All right, let us conclude. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 23 says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy. You know, things in the Bible are placed there not just randomly, but out of importance. The first thing it says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love. The second thing is joy. Joy. God knows you need strength to carry out the things that God wants you to do. Peace, long-suffering, the ability to suffer long. How many of y'all like that one? you better, because most folks you deal with, they're hard to, some folks are hard to deal with. There's some suffering involved. Gentleness, goodness, faith. You know, some people think faith is number one thing. It's way on down the list. God would much rather you have love than have faith. You know why? Because the Bible says faith works by love. You need love to activate your faith. That's why it's number one. Meekness, strength under discipline, self-control. Those are all fruits of the Spirit. These are supernatural gifts. You know, the love that you have today is supernatural. You know, Rob, you and I haven't known each other that long, but I know you love me. And I love you. And it's supernatural because it's not based on friendship as far as, I'd say we're friends, but we've never hung out together. We've never done that many things together. It's not like we've been to, you know, we've hung out, we was on a bowling league together, we went to high school together, none of that stuff. But isn't that weird how people can come into your life as Christians and you just feel connected and drawn to them? Desiree, don't you feel like you've known Beth all your life? I know. Isn't there the Yaha sisterhood thing going on there? Yeah, it's God. You know, I'm telling you, it's supernatural. That's how you know you're a Christian. The Bible says we know we've passed from death unto life. We're born again. We have eternal life. Because we love the brethren. Matt, there's a supernatural love you have for me and I have for you. Supernatural. It ain't natural. I ain't talking about funky. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But it's supernatural. Dave and I are buds, and man, we got nothing in common. I was a hippie, he was a redneck. Back in the day, we ran from those guys. They were trying to shoot guys like us. There he is. Run, hippie! Oh, mercy. But I mean, totally different things, nothing in common but Jesus. And boy, howdy, we are close. This joy is a supernatural joy. It's not based on something that you put together or that you made happen. It's supernatural. The Holy Spirit puts it in you, gives you a supernatural strength to get through things when, because you're going to go through some trials in life and you're going to need some joy because that's going to be your strength. And you're going to need peace. And you're going to need long-suffering. All of these fruits. Well, I like this one. I'll take a little of that. A dash of that and a pinch of this. It's not a recipe. You need all of them. They're supernatural. Hallelujah. Because the Bible says in James chapter 3, verse 16, it says, where there is envying and strife, there is confusion and every evil work. Every evil work. Now, I don't know about you. That sounds bad. You don't need strife in your home. Don't tolerate strife in your home. Don't make excuses for strife. Deal with it. If you can't fix it on your own, with the Lord, get some help. Get a big brother, sister, somebody, help you work it out. Say, hey man, I just can't seem to fix this. That's okay. We all need help. I mean, we can't do it, but we're not the quarterbacks. He may be important, but if he don't have any receivers, he's going to get tackled. If he don't have blockers, he's going to get tackled real quick. It's a team effort. We all need each other. Amen? I want you to live in peace at home, not just here on Sunday. We don't live here. We're here for an hour or two. We go home. This is not where we live. The presence of God's in this room. There is peace in this house. It's got to be in your house. I want to tell you something. This congregation, how many people come here and stuff, none of that to me is success. I don't measure success in ministry based on numbers or offerings or any of that kind of stuff. I base it on the individual lives of the people that attend here. I look at your life and I listen to the reports of people outside of church that talk about you. That's what I look at. When I hear that your neighbors love you, I'm doing something right. When I hear that people are saying, man, you're so gracious, you're so kind, that's when I know I'm doing my job. And I want to tell you something. I know most of y'all pretty well. When I say, put it this way, I know you in spirit. I might not know your souls and all the ins and outs of your life, but when you come, how many of you last week at church, did you feel like I was a fly on your refrigerator last week? You went, man, the things you were talking about were right, boom. I don't shoot with a shotgun. I shoot with a .22. With a .22, it's not a high power, not a high caliber bullet. You got to hit strategically to have an impact. Shotgun, there's enough BBs going out there. Something's going to hit something. I don't shotgun preach. Never have. More of a .22 pellet gun. I want to hit you right here. I want that little red dot right there. It keeps moving because I want it to impact you. Because there's a part of you that I want to see die. Because if that part dies, this other part will come alive. If your soul gets some dealings in it, lets go of the garbage you're hanging on to, then your spirit man will thrive and come forth, and you'll be known. You want to be known in this town as humble, a righteous, a loving person. You don't want to be known as that. They go to that church, boy, they're just fault finders, and boy, they gossip. She's got, man, don't tell her. It's telegram, television, tell Sally, and it's everywhere. You don't want to be known for that. You want to be known for being a loving, merciful, kind person. And you don't have to wear tons of T-shirts and crosses to let everybody know you're a Christian. Light is something you see, not hear. If we cut the lights off, it'd get dark in here. As soon as you cut the lights on, where does darkness go? It just leaves because it can't stay in the presence of light. We are the light of the world. People should see Jesus in you without... I don't even tell people I'm Pastor Mike. I don't introduce myself to people that way. I had one of the religious pastors here in town said, you shouldn't introduce yourself as Mike. You should introduce yourself as Reverend Mike or Pastor Mike. Why? Because then you'll get the respect. If I don't get the respect without the title, I don't deserve it. I found that when people know you're a pastor, they kind of talk different around you anyways. I want people to just, they're people. I want people to just be comfortable. I don't want people to feel uncomfortable around me. And then Jesus didn't, Peter, James, and John didn't walk in front of Jesus going, hey, everybody shut up, don't cuss at Jesus coming. The Son of God, Messiah, nip it. Larry, that means you. He didn't do that. They just talked. And he healed them and loved them and blessed them in spite of themselves. Just like he still does today. This is all about changing us. Amen? You know, I live with me 24/7. I don't know about you. You got to have peace here. And if I'm at peace here and I go to my house, I want that same peace in my house. And I'll tell you something. I want to make sure that I have that peace in my house. I'm not going to war in my own home. And when my kids were growing up, when they'd get rebellious and kind of get out there, I have had to say, if you're going to live in this house, you got to obey the rules. Or hit the road. It don't take people too long out there to find out the rules ain't that bad. Luke just moved out, and he told me the other day, he said, man, Dad, life's expensive. as a parent, you live for those moments. What? What'd you say? I heard him. I'm going to hear it again. Life's expensive. I mean, everything costs. Yeah, it's amazing how when you live in my house, you didn't see those little meters running as you're standing in the shower waiting for the cold water and the hot water to run out and the cold water to kick in. Oh, I'm done. Because there's a little meter out there on the hot water heater going ding, 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 ching, ding, 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 ching. But you know, at his house, okay, all right. Okay. I think I can use this towel 3 or 4 more times. Don't have to wash it. It costs $6 to wash this. The other day he said, Dad, I did laundry. It cost $6. I'm just like, I'm doing my best not to go, yes, thank you, Jesus. I'm just like, really? $6? Wow. It's funny. You parents, some of y'all are like, oh, I know that moment. Some of you ladies don't really get the whole revelation of how much work babies are till you have babies. And after you have 2 or 3 kids, you know, you start getting those really cool Mother's Day cards. Yeah. Dear Mom, yeah. I had no idea what I put you through. Takes a while, but you wait for those. We have them all saved at our house. You know, those are the ones you go, all righty then. Dad, now that I've had 3 children and they're 2 and 3 years old. Oh, thank you for being so merciful and kind. And thanks for not killing me, because I have been tempted to kill my children. Okay, it's time the kids come to Grandpa's house for a while. We live for those moments, amen? But we're all on the same journey. We're all going the same place. And we all have the same enemies. So nobody in this room, who do you think he was talking to? I'll tell you, everybody. I think he was aiming. Yeah, everybody. We all need this, amen? Live at peace in your home. And with your children, say, we're going to live at peace, or we ain't going to live like this, because I'm not going to live in strife. I'm not going to live in strife. There's every evil work. You don't want... I deal with demonic spirits all the time, and I'll be doggone if you think I'm going to let them deal with them in my house. Amen? I want peace in my house. Amen. So... how many of y'all going to come out and party with me today? We got some, Brim went to Costco yesterday, we got some cool sandwiches, and some of y'all going to bring some stuff, right? Or else we're eating sandwiches. But where's Alvin? Alvin, did you make your potato salad? Didn't make, oh. Whoa. Oh, man. Well. Hey, you know, it's fellowship, y'all, right? It's there's other things other than Alvin. It's good potato salad, but we're still worth coming over to see. We got cake. Got a big old cake. We're gonna have some good times and just fellowship. We're gonna have some good times. Amen. If y'all want to stick around town or come back down the hill, it's worth it. I live next to Mountain View. If you pass Mountain View going down the hill, I'm the first house on the left, a greenhouse up on, and a bunch of trees. There's a for sale sign out front. That's my house. Go up there. It's at 3:00. We're going to have a good time. Amen. Let's pray real quick. How many of y'all needed this? Yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah, we all did. Father God in heaven, I ask right now in Jesus' name, Lord, first of all, Lord, I want you to touch Marcy's body right now. Lord, I just ask that. The word says, if any sick among you, call for the elders, let them anoint them with oil, and the prayer of faith will heal the sick. We lay hands on her right now and say, in Jesus' name, we command every virus and everything that's warring against her health right now to subside and be purged out of her body. God, we just thank you that this, what's going on with you right now?
Sepsis.
In the name of Jesus, we curse it in Jesus' name. We say that every root of that infection just dies right now in Jesus' name. And we speak life over this body. And we thank you, Lord, that she is receiving health and strength. And Lord, honor her obedience. Honor her obedience today for coming to your house. Bless her in Jesus' name. Father, the rest of us, we pray that you would bring peace to our hearts. Lord, help us to live in peace and not in strife. That we purpose that we will war a good warfare in Jesus Christ, but we will not live in strife in our homes. Lord, help us to come under the obedience of your word and come to a place of rest and peace. We need to be edified in these last days. We got to stay built up, got to be encouraged. There's a dying world that's suffering, that's hurting. We need to be on our best game. We got to have the joy of the Lord. We got to have it. Not just run into it periodically. It needs to sustain us daily. So Lord, we thank you for the joy of the Lord. We thank you for that you'll give us your strength and your joy if we'll just walk in obedience to your word. So help us, help us, help us, Lord, to walk in that obedience. Lord, help us to humble ourselves and realize we need each other. We need each other. We can't do this alone. The hand can't say to the foot, I don't need you. We're all the body of Christ. We need one another. We need each other's strength and encouragement and prayers and love. More than anything, we need each other's love, Lord. So, Lord, because perfect love casts out fear. So, Lord, help us to love one another. Above all, we're just so careful to give you all the glory and praise. Bring us back at the house at 3, Lord, to fellowship and have some good times together and encourage each other in the Lord and just laugh and have some fun. We just thank you, Lord. Bless Sister Maureen this day, Lord. We honor her in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Sister Maureen defeated cancer. Yes, she did. She had pancreatic cancer. The doctor told her she has a 95% mortality. You got a 5% chance you're going to live. That's not the best report, people. You know what? She said, okay. And she went home and said, Father, I take that right now, and I just thank you, Lord. I reverse it. I say, I got every chance to live because of you. And she prayed. She went through chemo. She didn't even lose her hair. Man, that's awesome. Then they were so amazed at how quickly that thing shrunk, and then they was able to operate, and they feel like they got it all. So we're honoring her today. It's a surprise birthday party. She's coming out to the house, and we're going to honor her. So this is not just about fellowship. We're going to honor a precious saint. She's moving back to Jersey, so she really needs our prayers. But she's going back she's selling her house and going back to be around her kids. So as she comes out today, let's just love, honor, and amen, and just be proud of, that's the Jesus we love and we serve, amen. I'm so proud to know Jesus and walk with him because he heals us, he keeps us, he delivers us, he sets us free. He's good. Kayla, I'm so glad you came today. I love your smile and face. All right. And Mr. Seth, that's a miracle right there. You've seen a sign and a wonder right there. I don't know if I believe in miracles. You just saw one. I remembered it. I asked this guy's name during worship, and I still remembered it. And it's a funky name, Seth. How many Seths do you know? It's a biblical name. It's in the Bible. All right. Well, we're so glad you all came today. What's your name, sir, with the beard? Yeah, you. Kevin?
Kevin.
Kevin. I have a Kevin. Hey, he's got a beard, too. Y'all could be brothers. Well, I'm glad you came, my friend.
Yes, we are.
Who's this pretty girl next to you?
Carla.
We have another Carla. Y'all could be... Hey, we got bookends today. Hallelujah. Well, we're glad you came today. Hope you come back. Y'all remember the stuff you're going to throw away? Don't. Give it to James. He's moving into his new place on the 1st. I want to tell you something. James is moving up here from Escondido. He was rooming with some roommates and stuff, and he's making this is a journey of righteousness. He's breaking ties with some people that, that don't necessarily serve the Lord, and he's coming up here to try to go on with the Lord and get a place for his daughter and stuff. He's crossing that bridge, guys, to manhood. So let's help him cross that bridge. So if you guys got a furniture or something, seriously, most of us got stuff in our garage we keep waiting to think about what we're going to do with. Bless him. Hallelujah. Amen. All right, you're dismissed in Jesus' name.